Okay, this is the February 21st meeting of the Conway Board of Selectmen. We'll call the meeting to order. First item on the agenda is minutes for the February 6th meeting.
I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for the February 6th meeting.
I only had one question, and maybe it shouldn't be in there, but so we talked down here about meetings that we attended and about going to the superintendent's roundtable, and I had said that I went, and I don't remember whether or not I said you went, John.
I'll bring it up tonight.
So you weren't at this meeting. Okay, so
yeah, well,
okay,
just
great.
Mentioned it.
Okay, great. Yeah. So that was the only thing.
Okay. Yeah.
That's other right. than that. So other than that,
I made the motion. You second it?
I second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Meeting's carried.
Okay, next item on the agenda is warrants. We have three warrants. We have one vendor warrant for $125,693, a payroll warrant for $101,687, and a payroll deduction warrant of $26,574. I'll make a motion that we approve those warrants. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Meetings attended by select board members.
So I went to the meeting that I had told about 2 weeks ago, going to Comcast, and maybe we'll talk about it a little more later. But
okay.
So we did have our meeting at UMass, talked to Comcast about the extension.
Right, which is extremely favorable.
Extremely.
Yes.
Good.
Bob, do you have any?
No, I didn't get it.
Okay. I was at the Franklin County Select Association board meeting a couple of weeks ago, talking about the meeting schedule for this year and what topics we're going to have. I was at the Connecticut Valley Superintendent's Roundtable with Bob a couple of weeks ago. We heard a presentation by the Massachusetts Taxpayers Foundation, which was very interesting and not very encouraging in
no.
terms of the way revenues are coming into the state and some of the trends that are occurring that do not bode well for either the state or the municipalities. I was at a Massachusetts Municipal Association board meeting in Boston a couple of weeks ago, or actually last week. That was very interesting. Again, we talked to the Lieutenant Governor and a couple of her secretaries about some of the legislation that's coming up and how it will affect our towns and what we might want to do to maybe push those in different directions if we possibly can. I was also at a meeting of the Local Government Advisory Commission that the government recently appointed me to. So those are the meetings I've been at recently. It looks like I'm going to be in a lot more meetings in Boston. So,
mm-hmm. Good okay. thing it's not very far.
Yeah.
It gets good, closer.
Good thing. You know, especially when you have to be there at 8:30 in the morning.
Yeah.
Okay, do we have any citizens' concerns? Okay, no citizens' concerns. That's good. Old business, update on the draft warrant for May 8th, the annual town meeting. Tom?
Yeah, there are a few updates on this, some of which are based on the budget that I'll be presenting later.
Do you want to talk about this later, Tom?
Yeah, you know, I think I ought to. And the budget is going to have a different Article 2. I have not updated this Article 2. The budget will have a different one that's substantially higher, unfortunately.
Okay.
Ouch. And we'll talk about that later.
See
today.
How I...
Yeah, we'll talk,
yeah, yeah, it's
talk
under
about
the...
Yeah. During your...
Yeah. The budget. But there were... filled it out a little bit. Nothing new on it. One formatting thing I think makes it easier. Under each article where I have submitted by and recommendations, I just indented all of those. Come on in. Which I think makes it easier to tell the articles apart from
mm-hmm.
each other.
Yeah, that's what I do.
Read it. So just a little formatting change so far.
Okay.
Oh, the new item is, the major one is $29,000 for capital improvements at Frontier Regional High School.
What number are we talking about?
It's Article 9. That was sprung on me on Thursday. And that's Conway's share. That's 15% of the $182,000 cost.
The roof leak?
Right.
That's the roof leak.
Yeah.
That is exactly right.
Okay.
So that's the that there is a change in that.
Okay. Since we are not at 6:15 yet, and that's when our hearing is scheduled for, we'll move down to the Agricultural Committee Right to Farm Bylaw proposed for the annual town meeting.
I don't know that Jason's here yet. I think he'll be coming at 6:30 after the...
Oh, you think he will be? Okay.
Yeah.
All right, then we'll hold off on that. Okay, we're not going to have time to do your presentation. Bob, do you have a report on Comcast?
Sure.
Okay.
So the reason for this meeting was that Comcast was due to send us a new set of maps that would show us where they're going to extend Conway's network.
Mm-hmm.
And the hope was that they would be similar or better than the maps they sent us before.
Right.
And they appear to be pretty much exactly the same, which is very good news.
Okay.
To the extent I'm almost embarrassed to talk about it, because Comcast is treating us more generous than they are the other towns, and I could speculate on why that is, but
that's because of the good job you did in the last negotiation.
No, I think it's because of the high percentage of folks that subscribed after Conway did
Absolutely.
The extension after the last franchise agreement, and almost everybody in Northern Conway subscribed, and that motivates them to think that they could be a little more generous what they're funding. I mean, this is Comcast paying half or so of the cost of this extension, and the state paying mm-hmm. the rest, and Conway paying nothing. So, mm-hmm. so you know, we're in such a better situation Good. Than the non-cable towns. So there are on the order of 4 homes here in Conway that they won't be wiring. And I made a pitch for those homes. And we'll see. They haven't gotten back to me. And since then, I've learned of one more home that there was something slightly wrong with their map over them missing the last pole in Conway.
Mm-hmm.
And sort of this is where all the issues always come, is the last home of
sure.
the edge of town, or the last home of a string that they're extending. And mm-hmm. and so I've sent them photographs of the house and the poles, and they're gonna look into that. But basically,
that's a maximum number of 4 to 5.
So essentially, yeah. we're totally covered except for 4 homes.
Right, and the other good thing that they said, and this is something that's very different than our franchise agreement. For our franchise agreement, they basically send us a listing of the poles that they'll extend to,
mm-hmm.
and then all the homes that can get from those poles they will connect to. Whereas here, they sent us a listing of the homes they will connect and a listing of the homes they will not connect. So this is something that they don't do when we have a franchise agreement.
Mm-hmm.
And they did absolutely say, yes, their commitment is to wire every home in Conway except for the ones they've identified.
Wow.
Which is very good. You know, I mean, good of them to do, and helpful for us that so that they won't come along 2 years from now and say, well, that home, you know, whatever. No. So this is very good. Now, I mean, just for everybody who's listening, if you're on a long driveway and it's expensive for you to connect and you haven't chosen to connect in the past, this will not affect you. You know, the state is not funding to run wires down a long driveway. But so these are new sections of Conway Road that will have the cable go past their home. And the state is funding up to 300 feet down a long driveway. In our franchise agreement, we have 200 feet. So right. The state is going to fund a little bit farther down a long driveway than was in our previous franchise agreement.
Sure.
Yeah.
Good.
That's great.
Good. And I've contacted everyone whose homes are not, you know, who are not scheduled to be extended to. And I'm still hoping that Comcast will be even more generous with us, but we'll see.
Certainly a lot of what Comcast has done for us is because of your efforts on this.
Well, it's nice of you to say, John.
No.
Well, you've put a long time. Totally true.
It's a lot of time, but you know, Comcast has treated us very well, and I know that you know a lot of people have their complaints about Comcast as a company, but they've treated Conway well.
Yeah.
Even though they're expensive, as you stood up and down meeting and said one time, and you're exactly right.
They are expensive, and they get more expensive.
Yeah.
But it's very difficult to do without. So, you know.
So while we're talking about Comcast, and we have three more minutes.
Yeah.
We are missing a Conway rep to our Frontier Community Access Television station. That's funded by Comcast. We have community access television through FCAT down in Deerfield, and Conway is allowed to have three reps on their board of directors, and that's John and I. And if anybody would like to become a community access has an interest in community access television, we meet once a month, and the meetings are not onerous, and they do a good job.
Thank you, Bob. Okay. Okay, we still have two more minutes before the...
I can give a brief update.
That's great. Great. Let's do that.
Our state Senator Hines has asked whether Conway can provide space for a roundtable conversation on rural challenges and opportunities for Massachusetts, part of the second annual Commonwealth Conversation Day of events on March 28th. He's proposing to host that event from 9 to 10 a.m., and Conway is a convenient location for the senators who will be traveling by bus from Amherst. They're asking for a room that can hold a head table with microphones and a table for maybe 10 in the front, plus that head table for 10, plus seating for guests, about 30 to 50 chairs, and the press will be invited. I'm looking into whether the Congregational Church might have better space in the upstairs of Town Hall, especially with the men's room not being in peak condition.
Well, the downstairs of the church has space.
So we're looking into that, but we have accepted.
It's a great idea.
Okay.
Very.
Hopefully, the church accepts.
Well, yeah. Administrators of the four frontier towns met the superintendent last Thursday. That's Frontier. And shared our understanding of the past few years, especially including the budget, but also the minefield of regionalization, which might seem rational to outside observers, but which for some towns, including Conway, is unlikely in the near future. Though the possibility of creating some shared services or having some shared equipment remains. I also mentioned the structural problem of Proposition 2.5 vis-a-vis school budgets that annually exceed that by a substantial margin, and also that for towns that had reached their levy limits, they were faced with the choice of funding the schools or cutting the town side of the budget. Yeah. Regarding that, after this year, Conway's five-year rolling enrollment average should start to go down relative to other towns. The superintendent is slated to come in meet with you and the finance committee on March 6th.
Okay.
And finally, the energy committee may be ready to move forward with at least part of its redesigned town hall insulation project, perhaps as early as next week.
Great.
Do you know why it's going to go down?
There's a five-year average, and right now, Conway is at the peak of that. and other towns are going to start going up in their five-year average as Conway starts to go down, so.
Because I thought our elementary school was pretty full and we're graduating, you know, classes that are as large as we ever have, up to middle school.
Other towns are starting to get a lot more people.
Grow more, that's great.
Four towns last year or the year before funded the students from UMass to do a study. We never heard any more about that. What happened to that?
Yes, we did talk about that as well. UMass dropped the ball on that. There were a lot of students who were involved in that who had various changes and weren't doing it. They did hear from the fellow who was running it, Mark Hammond, I believe. He came in here. And he said about 2 months ago that, yes, he was going to get right on it and should be back to them in a month. So they're going to follow up with him again and see. Again, that's a resource study to see whether or not there might be shared resources. Some towns might take that as an opportunity to consider regionalization. I'm sure Conway will not.
Okay. Thank you, Tom. Okay, it's 6:17. We will start the Tom, would you get everybody in who's outside there?
Yeah,
sure. The public hearing.
Bob, how you doing?
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Bob Armstrong.
Hi. How are you?
Tom.
Lynn Graves.
John O'Rourke.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch you. Lynn Graves.
Lynn, how are you, Lynn?
Hi. Oh,
thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Bob Armstrong.
Nice to meet you. Tom Lawrence. Nice to meet you.
Yeah, can we get a sign-in sheet for everybody?
I've got one here. I'm going to send you around.
Joe, can you pull that other chair around? Then we'll have plenty of seats.
Before we start, open the public hearing, I'd just like to go over some background information on the law and how it pertains to this hearing. The hearing is carried on under Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 140, Section 157. And essentially, the hearing is triggered by complaints against dogs. We are the hearing authority, the select board here. We will hear and investigate what has gone on with the dogs. The hearing authority shall investigate or cause the investigation of the complaint, including an examination under oath of complainants at a public hearing in the municipality to determine whether the dog is a nuisance dog or a dangerous dog. Based on credible evidence and testimony presented at the public hearing, a hearing authority shall, one, if the dog is complained as a nuisance dog, either dismiss the complaint or deem the dog a nuisance dog. Or two, if the dog is complained of as a dangerous dog, A, dismiss the complaint, B, deem the dog a nuisance, or C, deem the dog a dangerous dog. Again, the select board is the hearing authority. If the dog is found to be a dangerous dog, there are a number of remedies that we can ask for. The seven remedies that go anywhere from humanely restrained to humanely euthanized. There is a, once the hearing authority makes a decision, there is a 10-day period in which the owner or keeper of the dog can appeal to the district court in the jurisdiction of the town, which is Greenfield. And that's the basic procedure. Just want to go over a couple of definitions. All right, under the law, under the definitions under Chapter 140, Section 136A, the definitions that apply to Section 157, a dangerous dog is a dog that either one, without justification, tax a person or domestic animal causing physical injury or death, or two, behaves in a manner that is that a reasonable person would believe poses an unjustified imminent threat of physical injury or death to a person or a domestic-owned animal. Again, the hearing authority is the Board of Selectmen. A nuisance dog, a dog that, one, by excessive barking or other disturbance is a source of annoyance to a sick person residing in the vicinity, okay, or two, by excessive barking causing damage or under other interference, a reasonable person would find that such behavior disruptive to one's quiet and peaceful enjoyment, or three, has threatened or attacked livestock, a domestic animal or person, but such threat or attack was not grossly disproportionate reaction under all circumstances. So those are some of the definitions under the law. Here in Conway, we have a dog leash law. The law simply states the bylaw requires restraint of any dog within the town of Conway by a chain or leash not exceeding 8 feet in length, unless such dog is on the premises of the owner or keeper, or upon the premises of another person with permission of such person. So our law simply says that if the dog is on your property, it's fine. If the dog is off your property, it needs to be on a leash. Okay, that being said, I will now open the hearing. The owner of the property where the dogs are housed, Robert Moriarty, of 651 Graves Road, has been informed by a personally delivered letter that the complaints have been received, alleging that the dogs housed on that property are nuisance dogs. Since the board received several complaints in writing of nuisance dogs, they are investigating the complaints under oath as per chapter 140, section 157. This hearing acts as that investigation, and all speakers who speak in the hearing will speak under oath. The complaint owner and dog officer or animal control officer have been notified of the hearing. During the hearing, all comments are to be addressed to the select board with the permission of the chair. At the conclusion of the hearing, the board may make an order regarding the dog. The owner may appeal that order within 10 days to the district court. All right, the first thing we'll do we have any of the complainants here? Okay. Do you want to give any testimony other than the letters we received from you, Mr. Hudson? No?
I don't think so. Thank you.
Okay. Do you wish to say anything?
Yes.
I didn't send any letters. I just called Tom and complained a few times, and Joe.
You know, the dogs, they're...
Let me give you the oath.
Okay. Do you solemnly, sincerely, and truly declare and affirm that the testimony you are about to offer is true?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Okay, I complained numerous times about the dogs. They've been, the first time I think I complained, they were at my chickens, running around my chicken fence. Another time I complained, I was out hunting one time, and I saw a little doe run by me, and 30 seconds later, I heard this bell coming through the woods, and next thing I know, I see these three dogs right on the hot trail of the deer, and I ended up calling Joe and the EPO, and I think the EPO went and visited the gentleman. When my wife and me walk by the house, the dogs constantly come running out like they're going to attack us. And I mean, it's fearful. It's not just one dog we're complaining about. We're complaining about three dogs. Let's make that clear, too. It's not one. It's three. And when they get that pack mentality, they come charging us. I mean, it scares me and my wife. I mean, it's gotten so that what I do now is when I see them come running at me, I go running at them, yelling at them, and they finally stop. But it's getting to be a little ridiculous. Just 2 weeks ago, they were down at 116. Those three dogs were down at 116. That's quite a ways from their house. And I've caught them numerous times in the woods where they shouldn't be. So, yeah, it's fearful for me and my wife when we walk by. It's getting to be a little ridiculous. And
have you or your wife been injured by the dogs?
No, like I said, you know, we basically, I've got to the point where I scream and yell at them and they go running back, you know. But they stop, they follow us, they come behind us, and that makes me a little nervous. So.
Okay. And any questions for Mr. Cousins?
How far would you say Route 116 from the residence is?
That's going to be at least a mile away. So. And then in my house, it's close to 3/4 of a mile at my house where I've caught them when they were circling my chickens. So.
Okay. Mr. Hudson doesn't want to make a statement. Okay. Joe, would you like to make a statement for us?
Just the list that I gave you guys that shows the times I've been there and various remedies have come up, as such as leash walking, building a fence, keeping them leashed, but they haven't come to pass.
Okay. Yeah, there's quite an extensive list of the reports.
I think
you
there's possibly others that I talk to people, but they wouldn't commit to coming in.
Okay. Mr. Hudson?
No.
Let me give you the oath here.
Yeah.
You solemnly, sincerely, and truly declare and affirm that the testimony you're about to offer is true.
I do. In addition to what I've put in the letter, I certainly would like to point out to you gentlemen that in my family there are two kids, two teenagers, and the four of us ride bicycles. And when these dogs go after you under those circumstances, that's pretty intimidating. Secondly, similarly to what has just been stated, a week ago Sunday, I watched the three of them chase an SUV down Graves Road, and then they, after they tired out of chasing the SUV, they turned around and came back, but there was no one around. They were totally by themselves. And that's pretty typical of the circumstances that we all experience in that neighborhood.
Right. Okay. Thank you. No, yeah, chasing cars, I mean, they're constantly chasing my vehicle when I go by. And I don't want to hit the dog. I don't blame the dog. I blame the owners, per se. You know, and you got to slam on your brakes so you don't hit them, and it gets to be a little, you know.
Any questions for Mr. Hudson?
Thank you.
Chief, do you have anything to add? All right, so we have Joe.
Yeah, the other concern I have is the fact that, as far as I know, they, to my knowledge, they're not rabies vaxxed at this moment.
Yeah, they are. Yeah.
Okay, in your report, you say that you don't, to the best of your knowledge, the dogs are not.
Are they licensed in the town of Conway?
They're licensed for 2016.
16.
Okay. And
they have to be licensed by the end of March.
There's three dogs. Two are licensed in Conway. Misha is not licensed. That I know for a fact.
Okay.
The two that had licenses, I don't know if they've, as of today, Jimmy Knowlton didn't have them licensed for 2017, but it does, she extends it till March, so they don't have to be licensed. Okay. If they're rabies vaxxed, then they would be currently licensed.
They are rabies vaccinated.
Miss, you're only talking to recognize. Okay. All right, anything else to say here? Okay. Bob, would you raise your right hand, please? You solemnly, sincerely, and truly declare and affirm that the testimony you're about to offer is true.
I do.
Okay. We've gotten a substantial report from Mr. Colucci, our dog control officer, our animal control officer. And we have three written complaints, aside from what Mr. Kosmeskis has said. What do you have to say?
Well, this kind of a complicated situation. I moved back, as you're aware, I moved back into town in July of 2015 after an extremely tumultuous divorce, which has not ended. I currently have full legal and physical custody of my three children because of things that have happened as a result of this divorce. Part of the divorce, I agreed to take on Raven, which was the family dog that we had before. Raven is not the easiest dog. She was a terrible roamer before. We've tried to work with her to keep her closer. When I moved back into the house, I moved back in with Lynn Graves, who owns the other two dogs, the German Shepherd and the Black Lab, Misha, Liberty and Misha, respectfully. It has been difficult with three dogs, with two. Liberty and Misha are good dogs. They tend to stay more in the yard, Misha especially. And once I have the three dogs that go out, in the beginning they were terrible. I mean, they would take off, and I had spoken to several neighbors who said they were a good distance away, so we tried, and in working with him, tried many different options in order to try and keep them in the yard. We had considered getting the electronic fence, and at this point, because of all the legal stuff that I have going on, I just can't afford to put in a physical fence or a in-ground fence to try and keep the dogs strictly in the yard. Given the fact that I have a 6-year-old, 11-year-old, and a 15-year-old in the house, the 6-year-old, this incident last Wednesday, he let the dogs out. And once those three dogs are out, sometimes they stay in the yard, other times they've taken off. They have, to my knowledge, going as far as they did last Wednesday, is the furthest they've ever been. And it's just two that took off last Wednesday. Misha was in the house. What had happened was my kids had appointments. My parents came to be at the house for when the two younger children got off the bus. Parker had let the dogs out. I came back with Paige, who is our oldest, after her appointment. My parents were there for a little while and they left. I had no idea that Liberty and Raven had taken off. Raven, before when I lived in the house, would chase us if we left or refused to go back into the house. This behavior is typical for the way she used to be. What I think happened, and I have no excuse for it, what I think happened is my parents left and Raven chased them and Liberty followed. I got a call from Anne Marie Brooks, who happens to be the girlfriend of my ex-wife, and she lives at 23 Boyden Road, and she explained to me that she had two dogs on leashes, and she had asked my ex-wife if they were my dogs or not. Ex-wife wasn't sure. She called me, I went right down and retrieved the other two. She explained to me that there was a third dog running around, and I explained the third dog, when she called, was sitting in the kitchen, on the kitchen floor. I have tried numerous different options, only letting them out in the yard at certain times of the day. We have one neighbor that walks by that I know is terrified of dogs. And I know his schedule early in the morning when he walks, that I keep the dogs in the house. We've had, with that specific gentleman, we've had confrontations. Even when the dogs are still in the yard and not even paying attention to him, he gets upset. And I can tell he has an anxiety with the dog. I don't want him to feel uncomfortable walking by the house. Mm-hmm. What I've reduced it to is just letting out one dog at a time, and where I can keep an eye on him when I'm home. But there have been instances that I'm at work and he's calling and the dogs are out. Mm-hmm. In a perfect world, I would have the backyard fence in so I could let them out, they could play, and we wouldn't be here mm-hmm. having this conversation.
Do they listen to your voice commands?
Liberty, Misha, and Raven, yes. Raven will push the envelope, but she's gotten to be a lot better than she was before. They will come when called, and they will abide by any commands that I give them. Mm-hmm. So their command is house, very simple. When they're out and I want them in, I call their name and say house, and they come right into the house.
Okay. Any questions for Mr. Moriarty?
Well, I think you need to be made aware that I think the leash law in our town, and you correct me if I'm making a wrong statement, is the leash law says that any dog in your possession has to be under your control at all times. Under your control means they can't be running out in the street, they can't be chasing somebody down the street. You have to have total control of those dogs, whether they're yours or you agree. If you have some dogs in your residence that you're taking care of, they're your responsibility, Bob, I think.
Yep.
I think you do know that. I know you have some misfortunate things you got happening in your life right now, but you're probably going to have to figure out a way to totally constrain these dogs.
Okay. Ms. Graves, yep. Do you have anything to add?
I just wanted to say that we didn't vaccinate.
Do you solemnly, sincerely, and truly declare and affirm that the testimony you're about to give is true?
I do.
Okay.
I just wanted to relay that the dog, two out of three dogs are vaccinated. Misha has a little issue with the vet since we brought her to get spayed at Dakin. So she's going Thursday for the sedative because she doesn't do vets. But two out of three, and then before, I think, what was it, March 15th, I believe, they all three will be registered in Conway.
Okay.
John, can I ask you a question? Or
sure.
Or me? Well, go ahead. So I was hoping to hear the solution. I mean, so far I haven't heard anything that would make me think this isn't going to happen again. I appreciate what you said, but
personally, I'd love to put a fence in. I just literally can't afford it. I'm looking at putting a run in the backyard, which I can just, they're larger dogs. They have a lot of energy, and we're trying to get the energy out, but I want to be able to put a run in the backyard so that I can click them on the run in the morning, let them out one at a time so that they can get their energy out. So we don't have these issues. I mean, I came to Conway for a reason, because when I looked at the house and drove down the street, I noticed everybody waved, and everybody was generally friendly.
Yeah.
I work a very public job, where in a town where people are not friendly and fighting over all kinds of small, little, piddly things, and I have to go deal with those issues. I don't want to be that neighbor, and I want to get along with my neighbors. And this has definitely created some animosity that I don't want to see, and I'm willing to do whatever it takes to resolve that.
The letters in here are scary, I'm just hoping how we're going to fix this.
Well, first of all, not that I'm looking to battle with anybody, because that's not what I'm doing. The letters, I don't know what's been written. I've met with him numerous times, some of them positive, some of them negative. We've tried to discuss solutions to the issues. I've tried to ask, who's complaining, not that I want to retaliate, but I want to resolve the issues. And I'm always told it's anonymous, or that somebody from the board is getting a complaint. But I don't have a way to try and resolve these issues with the people that have the issues, so we can work it out to where it doesn't come to this point.
Okay. Mr. Kosmas?
Well, I just want to say that when Raven was there alone, there was never a problem. It's when the other two dogs came in that the problems all started.
And that's with the letter of support.
Exactly.
That we got. Yeah.
And let me be clear. Personally, I kind of beg to differ. Raven has been difficult from the day I brought her home. And she has roamed. She has just been a very vivacious dog. The other two, when they're alone and Raven's not there, they're fine. They're not vicious. They you know, might bark, but they're looking for a pat on the head, if anything. They're not confrontational. I've even debated and talked to the kids, and it's really hard. This is the family dog, and she's the most difficult one of all of them. And I've had to have the conversation with the kids that I might have to find somewhere else for the dog to go. We've actually entertained a family friend who lives in Florida of sending the dog down there. We've also entertained trying to bring her to other people kind of closer by, but I'm struggling with that because they're the kid's dog. It's hard. It's three dogs. Two dogs are easy in comparison. Once you get that third, it gets to be a bit much. But I'm struggling with the fact that it's a kid's dog, but yet we're having these issues.
And I believe we're right there with you, you know.
Yeah.
Just how can we avoid whatever the next step is? And then, mm-hmm. So far what I'm hearing is we're going to be back here, you know.
No, I'm not saying we're going to be back here. You know, I want to resolve this so we don't have to come back here. We don't have to waste a Tuesday night having this conversation because you guys have other things to be doing, mm-hmm. aside from sitting here listening to me talk.
Yeah. So what's your immediate plan to resolve this situation?
The dogs need to be on some sort of run when they're at the house. That's the plan. I've put the run out, and I've given instructions to the kids that they only go out on the run in the backyard. I mean, it's not the full trolley run. Mm-hmm. I haven't set that up on a tree, but they don't do it. And it's you know, at the point that, you know, I have to make clear to them that I'm now in peril.
Mm-hmm. Have you explained to the children maybe that what the alternative is going to be if they don't follow your rules?
That has been, especially after receiving this letter, that has been explained. And, you know, the possibility of Raven being adopted out. I have the ability. She was a rescue dog from a black lab shelter in Sterling. They offered to take the dog back if I get in a situation where that is something that I have to do. With regards to that, that's the last thing the kids want. The kids, you know, would want, of course, would want the dog, but they would entertain the dog being adopted to somebody else.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So. Do we have any other testimony? Okay. All right. We'll close the hearing, and we will deliberate. Actually, I have one more question of our animal control officer. Do you think these dogs are dangerous?
When you put three together and they go aggressively, potentially, yes. They've had a lot of instances. They haven't bit anybody, but they have attacked at least two dogs, according to the people who were there. They did not break the skin. Whether they bit them or not, I don't know. I can't tell you.
Okay.
Wasn't there. The people were very scared. One was a jogger and one was a lady down the road.
But by the definition of dangerous dog in the law,
no.
they don't come up to that.
No.
Okay. So we're dealing here with a nuisance dog.
I would say so at this moment, yeah.
Okay. Nuisance dogs.
Yeah.
Yep.
And that would probably be a motion and a and a vote.
Yeah. We're you know, I'll make a motion that we make the decision that this, these dogs are nuisance dogs and not dangerous dogs under the definition of the law, which is in Chapter 140, Section 157. Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, so now we have to deal with what is our recommendation for Mr. Moriarty and Ms. Graves moving forward. What do we recommend they do with the dogs to keep this from going on again? Any suggestions?
I like your suggestion of having them on a run. You know, I mean, that's what people have. That's what I did with my dog. You know, you have to have dogs on a run, or I mean, a big dog. You know, a dog that wants to be outdoors and active, not a thing that sits on your lap.
We need to get a firm commitment from Mr. Moriarty and Ms. Graves that the dogs will be either confined or restrained in some way, so they're not out in the street threatening people or at least scaring people and other dogs.
Yeah.
Can we get that commitment from you?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. You know, ideally,
is that something?
Ideally, what I like to be able to do is have an area in the backyard that's fenced in that they can be allowed to go out and play and be dogs. But it's just not something that I can do right in this moment.
Put them on a run until we can.
Yeah.
But you can do something to restrain the dog. Right?
Yeah. Something you can restrain him with a rope or a leash temporarily.
We have runs tied out back. It's just,
I mean, I think that's what we're going to put in our ruling, that you've got to restrain these effective immediately.
Absolutely.
On your own property. And you can't, got to somehow make it so they don't get loose anymore. And I understand your theory in the future, and I think it's one of them. These underground fences, they're all one of them. My son had one with his dog, and it was a great thing. But at this point, where we've had so many complaints, something needs to be done immediately now. And you can't put that in this time. We all know that. So.
Oh, yeah.
So you've got no choice but to tie them up.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the only option I have.
If they get loose again and we get more complaints, it's going to come back to us, and then we're going to have to do something even stronger next time.
Yeah.
That's essentially what... Go ahead, Jim.
So, you know, you can't just tie them outside and leave them there either.
Oh, I'm familiar with the law. I enforce that law.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so we will issue an order to you over the next day or so, and you will have, if you don't agree with that order, you will have 10 days to go to the district court and appeal.
Yeah.
Okay.
I read the statute. So.
But hopefully this is the end, and we won't get any more complaints. Everybody will be happy. The dogs will be happy. The kids will be happy. You'll be happy.
Yeah.
And we won't have to go through this again.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Not yet.
Ooh.
Thank you.
Tom, I'll put some language together and I'll send it around tomorrow and we can tweak it. And then
okay. That will be Lisa.
Okay. Oh, right. You're going to the sun. Okay.
Sure.
You're going to the warm plants?
Yeah.
And then we will tweak it and we'll send it out to Mr. Moriarty and Ms. Graves. And hopefully be the end of this.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Probably Jason next.
Okay.
Hi, Jason.
Hey, Jason. How are you? Thanks for coming in.
Glad to get to spend some time with
you. Hi, neighbor. You can come in. Yeah.
Hey, Roy.
Have a comfortable chair.
Thanks for volunteering to be on the ag commission, Tim. Appreciate it.
Jeff Hurst is next door.
All right, Jason, you're here to talk to us about the right to farm bylaw proposed for this next town meeting.
Sure.
Okay.
And I did bring some copies. I don't know if you guys have them.
Yeah.
We have them.
Yeah. Now, is this, it's just a redo of the law that you, or the warrant article you put in last year?
Yeah, or two years ago.
Did you make changes?
2 years ago,
yep.
Right.
Yeah, we made a deal with them. And in the copy you guys have of 6 pages, the second 3 pages are showing the changes we made. And it's actually the copy I find more convenient to look at, where things with strike-throughs on them are, and if you don't have them, I've got extra copies of that on here. But it shows things we deleted with strike-throughs and new things we added in bold, so it sort of helps to clarify what changes we've made since the last time it was proposed.
Yeah. Do you think that these changes will be met with more favorable results than last time?
Yeah, we're definitely hopeful.
Okay.
Okay. We tried really hard to address the major concerns that were brought up, and we talked to some other folks in the community and talked to other AgComs too to see what kind of issues people are facing. And we're feeling confident about it. We got some good feedback at our open forum.
You want to talk a little bit about the open forum?
Yeah, sure. We had an open forum in February, or that was in January actually, where we invited folks from the community to come and kind of field questions. We had about a 2-hour question and answer and sort of, explain the reasoning behind some stuff and got some good feedback. So this is actually a draft that's come out since that open forum to incorporate some of the feedback.
Great. How many people attended?
I want to say it was about a 10 to a dozen or so people that came.
Okay. It seemed like there was a small group of people that were strongly opposed to the other one.
Oh, at the town meeting that it
yeah.
Yeah, right.
Were they there?
They weren't. Will Cody, who actually joined the Agriculture Commission after that, he did send us an email sort of outlining his thoughts on it. He said he was generally in definitely in favor of the changes.
Was he opposed to it last time?
The last time it went around, he wasn't opposed to it. He just had some concerns with the wording in it. So, so it ended up getting tabled at the last meeting that it was
right.
brought up at.
Right.
I think several of us in the commission, agreed that it needed another look at, because the original version that was proposed is really kind of that template that's put forward by a lot of towns in the state. And a lot of towns just have kind of that boilerplate as their main right to farm bylaw.
Okay.
So it's based on that framework, but it's some additions that we thought fit better with the town and fit better with people's concerns.
Great. Okay. Yeah, looks looks a little less onerous than last time.
Why did you cross out fur-bearing animals?
That was a debate we had. One of the things we were talking about within the group, and it addressed some concerns some people had about, large, whether it's fur-bearing farm or industries in here, and just sort of something we wanted to distance ourselves from a little bit, because it's state law still supersedes all of it. It's not like we're disallowing anything, because there's really no regulatory authority in here other than when people buy or lease a property, being handed the statement saying that this is a right to farm community. It's in section 3. There's a declaration that people are giving when they're moving to town. So just for the scope of this, for sort of putting priorities that we thought were important, we decided to not include that in this version.
Okay.
Will this be affected at all by the question? Was it question one? I forget which of the questions. One of the questions.
I'm trying to remember which question
had to do
was.
With animal rights.
Not directly. Although I'm sure that if some disputes were to come up and somebody were to cite some of those, that that could be a point that resolving the conflict, I'm sure that will get brought up if something.
It seemed like that had mainly to do with chickens,
right?
But it really seemed like it was a bigger, more general
bigger.
Question.
And it'll raise some challenges too, if because there's some language in it that's a little unclear. But one of the biggest things we wanted to do with this was to make sure that the Agricultural Commission was part of the mediation process should disputes
right.
come up. So, we've seen in other towns. Right to farm sort of being misused in both directions, both giving farmers way too much power and also giving abutters way too much power. And we went and met with the Massachusetts Association of Agricultural Commissions at some of their meetings talking about right to farm. And the biggest thing they really emphasized was that this is not supposed to be authoritarian. It's just supposed to be clarifying to put forward that it's a town that supports farming, but then also have clear conflict resolution within it. So one thing we added was making sure the AgComs involved in that process.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that sounds like a very good idea. Okay. Any other questions for Jason?
script room. It's a work in progress, I guess, once it gets voted in, I mean.
Sure.
If there's changes to be made in the future, they'll get added in or taken out or.
Exactly.
Yeah, it looks like a pretty good starting point for me.
Thank you, Jason.
Yeah.
Appreciate you coming in.
For having me.
Take care.
Thank you, Jason.
Were these copies useful or do you guys have the whole?
We got one.
The changes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Tom, you're up.
Okay.
Okay. I am very pleased to present you with a budget.
See, he's presenting this to us tonight and he's leaving tomorrow.
Oh, yeah. It's known as dropping the bomb.
Dropping the bomb, huh?
And I already have a whole sheet of addenda here. Okay, there's only four of them.
Of everything missing?
Things that are, that bear on it. Walk you through a little bit. There's a rather large introduction for about the first 12 pages. The first five of that is a general discussion of the financial situation of the town. You can see on the very first page a summary of revenues and expenditures showing that this budget is indeed in the black, mm-hmm. but just.
Mm-hmm. As of today, Tom?
Yeah. There are areas which will change. Drawing your attention to the addenda first, probably just to get those out of the way. There is an additional $30,000 in free cash that is unassigned to a particular expense. It is not included in either the revenue or the expense charts here. But if you added it as expense, it would automatically be counted as revenue too. Otherwise, it'll just roll over into next year. That is primarily because not all of the records are set. As you saw, this is the first time I've gotten the final Franklin County Technical School budget. The Smith Vocational budget is also not in. We do have preliminary budgets for Frontier and the Conway Grammar School that are much closer than they were. That said, they were higher than expected, so I had to do some quick juggling last week.
So is that why you said this is going to go up?
Yes. Yeah. The correct version of that is on the last two pages of this budget. You'll hear from Joe Strugowski. He'll be meeting with the Capital Improvements Planning Committee.
Mm-hmm. This meeting tomorrow?
It's meeting tomorrow night. He's a little bit concerned that if it doesn't go forward now with Dave Chichester leaving, who's been a great help to him on that, that it will not be as easy for him to move it forward in the future. I agree that it's a concern for the town, but it's up to you how to deal with it on this particular warrant. Anyway, I've proposed that as a borrowing item to borrow for the engineering. And the cost for that would be $1,100, not the $2,000 that I have in this budget. Franklin Regional Council of Government expenses are in, although program fees are only $38 more than what was budgeted. There seems to be an increase in radio fees beyond the expected increase, which could be on the order of several thousand dollars. And I am checking this out with fire, police, and ambulance departments now.
How much were they estimated at now, Tom?
They're estimated at almost $3,000 for fire, police, and ambulance.
Each department?
Yes.
Wow. That's quite a bit more than we estimated.
Yes.
Yes.
Final figures for the schools are not yet in, as I've noticed, though we have an assortment of preliminary figures. So all that said, this is a starting point for the budget. Obviously, you, the Finance Committee, and the town meeting won't have your say. It's also now on the website. it appeared there magically during this meeting. I just love technology.
Okay.
So I cover a lot of general things. I note that there are six possible capital projects.
What page are you on?
Page six now. And I just list the things that I've heard of as possible major things that we could consider spending on. These are things that I hope the Capital Improvements Planning Committee looks at, prioritizes, and schedules. The new highway garage, town hall improvements, which I think should include renovations to this building as well. A downtown wastewater collection and disposal system, senior housing, a municipal community solar field, and a public safety complex are all major capital items that have come up since the time that I've been here that deserve attention and planning.
Mm-hmm. Any of those that'll happen this year?
We don't know yet.
Well, we don't. Yes, we don't know. I do have money for borrowing for the downtown wastewater engineering should you decide to move that forward.
In this budget, yeah.
But that's only for the cost of borrowing, not for the borrowing itself, which we wouldn't see until the following fiscal year. There's some notes on selected money articles for this year, just to let people know a little bit more about why those are on. A little bit of a discussion of significant budgetary items and trends. A nod to our financial policies. I've gotten a new version of that from Joe Markarian, which we can start moving forward on. I recount what the budget process was like and include the memo that I sent out. Then I go over revenues in more detail on page 12 and 13. And I have to say I'm indebted to the accountant for her help in reviewing all of these figures and helping me get them all correct. Mm-hmm. The expenses I have starting on page 14 with a broader discussion of the potential expenses and then breaking it down into the four categories that are traditionally used: general government, public safety, public works, and education, health, and human services. Give a chart showing the relative distribution of that, mm-hmm. With the change from last year to this year, proposed, of course. And then the bulk of the document is going through each of those categories, broken down into line items and within the line items by sub-accounts. Mm-hmm. At the very end, just before the very end, I include an organizational chart of the town.
So we went over all of these in our meetings that we've been having. Are they all the same?
Pretty much? Mostly, yes. And you didn't go over all of them, but all of them are in there.
Yeah, great. That's great.
And yes. You'll notice that I am also including in this budget an audit, which you may or may not want to keep.
Right.
But it we can pay for it if we want to.
Mm-hmm.
On page 40, because of the new format where I include salaries as separate line items and group some of them together, I include just a text explanation as to what I've done and why. And I'd like to send that out also with this year's town meeting as a separate sheet, maybe as a cover sheet to say, this is why it looks different than it used to. This is what it's intended to do. And hope that people come to town meeting prepared to look at the new version of that.
Mm-hmm.
You can see on page 41 at the very bottom line that, largely due to education and healthcare costs, The budget is up even more this year than it was last year. There was a time before last week when the new figures came in that I was hoping that it was going to be about as much lower as it is higher. Yeah. And you see that in my my original chart in the warrant here. So it was quite a shock to me to get the new figures in. And it is a substantial increase. Mm-hmm. But these are the items that we have to play with, more or less, along with the considerations in the addenda that I've given out. And I can make sure that this technical school budget gets distributed more widely as well. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So that's the brief tour.
Thanks for spending time on it.
Yeah,
great.
Great. Well, read the major.
Thank you. Great job.
Yeah,
thank you.
Very nice. Very comprehensive.
I'm pretty sure that all of the figures agree with each other. It is.
I'm sure we'll be tweaking something between now and.
Yeah,
sure we will.
Several people have helped me do this, of course.
None of this was we probably too early to put this into thought, but if none of this was tweaked out and left the way it is right now, what would be the tax rate increase in the town of Conway?
That is on page.
Did you name Tom? I missed it.
Five, I think. It's not on page five. It is in here. Ah, yes, page 10. Sorry. First paragraph on page 10. The bold sentence there.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Now, there's a lot of ifs in that statement.
Yeah, of course. We understand that. Yeah.
It is an alarming trend that even with that increase, we're still on track to be only about the 10th highest in Franklin County.
Yeah.
As state funding for towns and cities has gone down over the last 10 years, and the state auditor has a remarkable report showing this, cities and towns have made up the slack. And of course, a large part of that has been funding for schools.
Sure.
And if you look, about 12 years ago, the lower end of the tax rates in Franklin County were at about $10 per thousand, excluding Irving and Rowe, who have their power plants to subsidize them. And the higher end was about 17. Mm-hmm. Now, the higher end is about 22, and the lower end is up to about $12 or $13. So, towns are uniformly going up. No town in Franklin County yet has hit the $25 amount, which is the maximum that a town can charge. However, there are at least a couple dozen municipalities within the Commonwealth who have hit that $25 barrier. And my sense is that there will be increasing attention to this at the state level. You know, it's one solution would be to amend Proposition 2.5 to allow people to tax themselves, you know, more. Another solution would be a change in priorities at the state level. Mm-hmm. And of course, federal aid to states, cities and towns and all that plays its share as well. So right now, towns and cities, I think, are taking a disproportionate share of the increased burden of spending over the last 10 or 12 years.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a great segue to the next item, Tom. As you guys know, the governor appointed me to the Local Government Advisory Commission. It's a 40-member commission, 8 members of whom are selectmen. So I was honored to have been selected. One of the reasons for this commission is to, or
there are a number of reasons for this commission. And essentially, I'll just go over them briefly. And Lisa, I have these written down so you don't have to go crazy with typing. The commission is responsible for reviewing and analyzing proposed legislation and regulations. Changes from the point of view of municipal government and present such points of view to the governor, his executive secretaries, and the general court. The commission is to act as an independent advocate for the interests of local governments in their relations with state and federal governments, to advise officials of the Commonwealth and the federal government on the needs of local governments, assist in mobilizing state and federal resources to deal with problems of local governments, provide coordinating support to agencies responsible for administrating federal, state, and local programs, promote legislative and administrative proposals reflecting the interests of local governments. So you can see this whole emphasis is on the members of this commission talking to the governor, his secretaries, and the general court concerning, you know, the smaller municipalities in Massachusetts.
Big laws like this.
We can establish from time to time study committees or task force to consider issues pertaining to local government in detail and to present results of those considerations to the governor, the secretaries of his executive offices, and the general court. It'll involve a monthly meeting with the governor. It'll involve quarterly meetings with the legislative leadership. And again, it is to promulgate rules and regulations governing its procedures and those of the executive committee. So it's, you know, basically we're getting an opportunity through this commission to speak directly to the governor and his secretaries, which is, you know, again, something that's pretty important. And hopefully, and I think the governor and his lieutenant governor have been very attentive to the needs of the municipalities because they both came up the line as selectmen. Okay, they both served in local government, so they understand, you know, like a lot of, unfortunately, a lot of the legislators do not understand what goes on in individual towns and at the local level. So it's going to be a very interesting role in this situation, and I will certainly keep everybody informed as we go along. So. It should be fun, but as I say, there'll be a lot more meetings in Boston. So,
quick question, John.
Sure.
So there is a group out here that meet periodically called the Small Town Summit. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you know of them.
Yes, I do.
And I went to a meeting with them a little while ago, and they had a set of issues, and so I wrote to them and said, you know, I would love to pass on their issues directly to you. I hope that's okay.
You know, absolutely. And I sent a letter out to all the selectmen in District 1 of the 89 towns.
Yeah.
And the town administrators saying, you know, tell me what's happening. Did we get those letters today?
Yes, you did. They should be in your folders, but they're certainly here.
Okay. Good.
I did put them in the wrong place. I'm sorry about that. Don't you get them out now?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure. Matter of fact, I think you got one.
Well, I wanted to send myself one just to make sure it got to us.
You know? God forbid you forget yourself.
It was strictly a check on the Postal Excellent. Service. Excellent.
You know? So some of these issues are very interesting, and Adam Hines came to our last meeting, which I thought was really good. And,
sorry about that.
Thank you.
It's yours.
Oh boy.
Yours.
Look at that.
And some of them are not issues that we have here in Conway. So Buckland has some very interesting issues dealing with zip codes. And
yes.
The way that the state uses zip codes in ways that really don't work very well. And if they said Buckland, it, you know, rather than a zip code, it would make their life easier, and they so far haven't found a way to get the laws changed to avoid using zip codes.
Yeah, that may be a federal issue.
I don't know.
Because of the
you know,
post office.
In talking to, in going to some of these selectmen's conferences all over the state and talking to selectmen, it's amazing how the problems we have here are problems that bigger municipalities have. It's basically the same problems, but the scales are different in most cases. So it's kind of interesting.
Not enough money to go around.
Well, one of the problems that they argue, and I'm not a labor expert, but they argue about the prevailing wage law and the ways in which prevailing wage law is very onerous.
At the Massachusetts Leadership Conference, I guess it was back in November, that was one of the things that was brought up, because you know, for a municipality to build something, it's 30% more.
Right.
30% more.
Because of prevailing wage. 30% more.
And that's preventing a lot of your small communities from doing anything.
And certainly another issue that was brought up was this engineering issue. You know, like the cost of engineering when you have situations like bridges. Why don't we have, you know, a template for a 20-footer, a 30-footer, right. A 40-footer, a 50-footer?
Canned plants, yeah.
Exactly, because, you know, to put together, well, look what it cost us to do the highway garage for plans, okay? That was a steel building, and it cost us an amazing amount of money for engineering plans, you know? It's just nuts, you know? But that's the purpose of that advisory commission, so I think it'll be very helpful for us.
I'm glad you're on the job, John.
Yeah, I'm on the job, Bob.
You sure are.
Tom, you already gave us the update. Do we have any concerns of the selectmen? Any concerns?
I have one. Just Tom and I had some discussions this week. Bob and I at the last select board meeting asked to have Ron. We had discussions about the hired employee getting through and how I felt it was very important, and Bob felt the same way. It was very important in getting the process advertised quick-like so we could get another town employee in here. See, we still got 2 months of winter left, roughly, and that which we could get very good snow still. And Tom made me aware that I guess we'd officially never took a vote. I mean, I thought we had done it, but it was not an official vote taken, and maybe we should do that tonight.
Well, I'd rather not do that without Ron. I mean, we really should talk with the
but
highway.
But every time we go meet with Ron, there's another week gone by. Now we've already gone 3 weeks past it.
Yeah, he's covering that with contractors, right?
He isn't. I don't think so.
That's certainly his plan. Yeah. I had hoped he would be able to come in tonight to talk about it, but unfortunately he's sick. Yeah,
he's got the flu like everybody else.
Yeah.
Well, we've had some not so good luck with that last person for the crew. We had the one person we hired who
never showed up.
And then we had the person we hired who was here for
a couple days.
A couple of days.
You know,
who basically quit.
The way I also look at it is this is, to me, would be a great time of year to advertise for a position, because a lot of your construction outfits have got people laid off right now, and they may be looking to want to get a permanent year-round job.
Well, that was certainly the case with the last one.
If we stall this off till April or May, these people are all going to be going back to work.
Well, if they're working in private construction, they're going to be making a lot more money than
they would.
Well,
you understand that. One of our biggest problems is we don't offer enough money to get a real qualified candidate. I understand that.
We may want to rethink the laborer position. I know Ron wanted to save money with that, but
maybe we need to bump it up a bit.
So this is a discussion, yeah.
I think we do need next to time have we can get Ron in, we'll discuss
can
that.
Can you have him in next week?
Yeah.
And we can discuss that with him?
Put that on the
agenda. Yeah, and advise him that, you know, I think we need to go back to a CDL operator and pay him the rate the other guys are getting to get somebody these. It's like the in-between person just isn't out there.
What's CDL?
Commercial driver.
Okay.
All right, how does that interrupt or disturb the pay scale of everybody else?
It's probably, $2 an hour?
It would be another $3.50 to $4.
$4.
It's certainly not in this budget.
Okay. We may have to put it
in. I don't know how
maybe
much.
Maybe we can get Ron to recategorize something, some items. Then they can put it in the budget. We can talk about that.
Yeah, we'll start talking about that. Mail. Okay, what do we get in the mail?
Do you need a vote? Official vote on that, Tom?
Can I
Ron come in?
No.
Were you here to talk to us about something?
No.
Oh, it's awesome.
I'm sorry.
Nice always to see happy you. To put something on the agenda.
Roy, do you have anything for us?
No, I was just here to...
Really?
Okay.
The budget.
All right. You hear it right from the...
I hear you're doing a great job on the phones and the computers.
You are trying to please as many people as we can, but you never get them all. So.
Thank you, Roy.
They work when I call. I know.
All right, well, thanks for you. Okay, good night.
We got a thank you letter for the Germain Scholarship. You guys seen that? Okay. And we also just received the wage and salary survey for fiscal 2017 from Franklin Regional Council of Governments. Okay, in the mail. Okay, any other announcements? Okay, our next meeting is scheduled for Monday, February 27th at 6 o'clock in the town hall across the street because we're meeting with finance.
Finance is
okay.
That's right.
And you're not going to be here.
Mm. But I have given them copies of the book.
You're going to be sipping Mai Tais on the beach somewhere?
Maybe.
Let's hope. Mail some back.
Okay. If there's no other business to come before the board, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Are we going to go to?
We'll go into executive session and we'll adjourn out of executive session for reason number two, to conduct negotiating sessions with a non-union employee. Okay. Thank you.